To KwaZulu-Natal now, where the Newcastle municipality's tower block offices have been temporarily closed. This after two municipal employees tested positive for COVID-19. The employees are currently in isolation. Officials say the necessary disinfection and decontamination measures are done. But in the interim, what does this mean for essential frontline staff? Will the basic services to the communities be impacted? Let's get some answers. Newcastle Mayor Dr. Ntuthuko Mahlaba joins us now via Skype. Mayor, very good morning to you. Thanks for joining us. Welcome to The Agenda.
Good morning to you and all the viewers at home.
Now, the municipal tower block building will be closed until Sunday, we understand. The municipal staff are being urged to stay at home during this period until the entire building has been decontaminated. So what sort of impact will this have on service delivery?
Well, one, in terms of service delivery, we've made sure that we continue to provide services because we have other satellite offices. The tower building is mostly the administrative building. The only part which will be affected, but not so much, is that of rate collection, because the rate hall is closed. But other services like roads, electricity, your community service, grass cutting, cleansing, all of that, water, is continuing as usual because we're using other satellite offices and the field staff. The reason why we did this because we don't want to risk employees and get more of them infected and staying at home, because that will destabilize the municipality and hamper service delivery. So we started from yesterday to disinfect the building, but Monday everything will be back on normal.
Now, the issue of strategic testing, effective isolation, and rapid contact tracing, these are extremely important in the fight against this virus. Is this happening optimally in your municipality?
Yes, it is. We've encouraged our employees, those who have through our programs inside, who have even symptoms, and to go and test even those who are contacts of the employees who tested positive, to go and test. But also Department of Health is doing very well to make sure that they roll out the testing, screening and testing. That is ongoing. We are seeing a rise in the number of cases. Well, that is expected, as the minister said, but it's also because there is a good testing program that is currently underway. And what we are doing in the municipality, we are taking all precautions in all our entrances to make sure that we screen every employee, and we encourage them as well to, we are trying to make sure that in our buildings, we minimize employees who come inside. We minimize them by making sure that those who can work at home continue to work at home and maximize their input whilst at home. But also we're encouraging a shift system to avoid a large number of employees at one go in the building. But the reason why we're doing this is because we don't want to stop service delivery. We want to make sure that we continue to provide services to our communities.
Now, you see the rising numbers, rising in South Africa, and the death toll spike, I beg your pardon, is causing trauma for so many people. Can your municipality cope with a surge in COVID-19 cases?
Yes, it is. Causing a serious strain to everyone. Maybe before I comment on that, I must say, all of us must understand that COVID-19 is here with us and it's going to be with us for some time. And we must expect that the majority of us, in one way or the other, will at some point test positive. But what is important is to stick to the regulations as stipulated. We always encourage, as we did here, what we've done, because we've noticed that one of the most important things is to raise awareness. We continuously, as a municipality, go to dense populated areas like taxi ranks, bank courts, to raise awareness and also provide face masks to our communities, so that we and also sanitizers and soaps to those who need it, so that we can ensure that our people are safe. Because the reality is that Now, when we speak of COVID-19, all of us are not now just relating to statistics, we are relating to names, because it has affected even people who are very close to us, our relatives, our neighbors, our friends, colleagues. We are now talking about something that we see in front of us, and as the minister said, it's no longer about the statistic, because the statistic is expected, there will be a sharp rise in the number of cases. But what is important for all of us is to make sure that we take precautions, and us as the municipality, in the main, is to make sure that where we work, we have proper precautions to make sure that our employees are safe, to make sure that the residents of Newcastle are safe, and to make sure that we provide basic services that will enable them to stay safe and encourage them that people must stay at home. Lockdown is still on, we're on level 3, but what we need to do, we need also to educate our people that you only leave home as and when it's necessary. You don't just go out because you are free now, there's no curfew. Let us stay at home, stay safe, sanitize, keep a social distance, wear our face mask in public, and make sure that we protect everyone around us.
Now, the healthcare workers are under immense pressure, and as a medical doctor yourself, are you willing to roll up your sleeves to help out? I mean, are you willing to channel the necessary resources towards supporting these healthcare workers, such as, giving them the necessary resources and, just making them sure that, they institute or execute their mandate optimally?
I'm working myself. That's why I'm saying this thing now we're relating to names. We're working. This week alone, I've seen about 8-10 patients who tested positive, but they are doing well. We're making a follow-up on them. They are at home, they're self-isolating at home. They are doing very well. Last week as well, I saw a number of cases who tested positive. They are doing well, there is a serious strain. As the minister mentioned, my worry is that we may end up running out of beds, and that will be now a serious problem. But I'm sure with the effort that the government is putting from national, even in our province here, our MEC, we are doing very well in terms of trying to prepare the ground for that period. We must also understand healthcare workers are human beings as well. There will be anxiety amongst them, because also their families, when they come back from work, when they get home, they are staying with their families, they are staying with their children, they have neighbors. They are human beings, they are part of the community. There will be that anxiety. They also need maximum support from everyone, members of the community, from government and everyone, to make sure that they continue to discharge their services with excellence.
Now, speaking of the shortage of beds, do you have a contingency plan?
No, I would say from the preparations, government, especially, I will talk about where I am. The work is in progress. It's continuing very well, because I've seen it in terms of preparing beds to make sure that as the number of cases increases, we were also ready. I've seen it, and I'm quite sure that the government will be equal to the task, will be able to manage the situation. But what we need is that everyone must stick to regulations. You see, we need to take all necessary precautions to avoid or to prevent infections, because if we can do that, we will be able to cope with the number of people who may need to be hospitalized. Unfortunately, conditions in some families do not allow them to self-isolate at home. That might be a challenge at some point, because some of them live in serious. For instance, we had a family that had 18 members living in a two-room house. Now, if a member of that family is infected, test positive but is not sick, is not symptomatic. The challenge is where do they self-isolate? Those are things that I think we need to also look into so that we are able to deal with the crisis that we are having.
Now, in your recent budget address, you vowed to tackle corruption and to eliminate unnecessary perks for officials. You also spoke about launching an investigation on those who are responsible for, as per your statement put it, the nearly collapsing of the municipality. So have you instituted this investigation as yet?
Yes, we already started. We started some few months ago. Investigating their projects, which I started many years, 5 years ago. Budget was depleted on those projects, but projects are not completed. The report is ready to serve in front of council in the next week. We also noticed that there are ghost employees. For instance, there is an employee who just decided to pay herself about 2.6 million. We've suspended, is going for DC. We also made sure that she signs an agreement with the municipality, whilst also other processes are ongoing, that she will seek a pension to recoup that money, which is about 2.6 million. But she's not alone. We've noticed that there are others, and hence we've started the process of looking into our payroll system, our HR processes, to make sure that we close all the gaps. But also, we decided that, we can't have a situation where we continue business as usual. Senior managers have big packs, big cell phone allowances. Whilst we have a challenge, we owe Eskom, we have historical debt with Eskom. We need to service that debt, because also Eskom must be able, as an organ of the state, to discharge its duties of energy production. On our side, what we need is to commit in making sure that we put all necessary measures in place to service the debt that we owe Eskom, and put good governance and put a good work ethic in the municipality, so that we are able to serve our people and discharge our core functions, which is water, electricity, roads, sanitation, the provision of a clean environment, etc. So these are the things that we want to make sure that we root out corruption and be able to deal with a proper service delivery. What I can say, since we started here last year, the project that we launched last year, I'm happy to say we were able to complete them within the budget, within the financial year, despite the fact that we had the challenge of COVID-19. They were completed, and in some projects we even made savings, which will be channeled towards other projects, infrastructure projects.
You know, you've just highlighted some of the measures that the municipality is taking to root out corruption. I mean, just earlier this year, you were quoted as having said that corruption should be, branded as a treasonous crime. But we know that corruption within the municipality has been so deeply embedded and deeply entrenched for years. And there's been a wide network of patronage within the municipality. And fighting corruption and rooting out corruption will not take a month. It'll not take a year. It'll take so many years. And that comes at a cost. And the finances that the municipality has admitted that it does not have. So how do you seek to fight corruption?
Yes, it's going to be a process. One, it will start with us making sure that we put proper processes and systems in place. And secondly, we need to have a strong consequence management. Without any fear or favor, because the challenge is that, you see, those who have been living off the municipality will start here and there to make noise, will start to try and divert the attention from what we are doing. But ours is too much gone. Look at the problem, put the systems in place, put proper processes in place, make sure that we have competent people to run specific sections, and make sure that our internal controls are up to scratch. One of them, as I mentioned, if you don't have a proper payroll system, you don't have a proper exit system from the municipality, that is a breeding ground for those who want to have ghost employees. But number two, we need to have a serious consequence management in terms of both service providers to the municipality contractors who do not finish their work on time or exceed the budget that is prescribed, that they bidded for. Number three, we need to make sure that even in terms of officials in the municipality, there is proper consequence management without any fear or favor. Obviously, this will come at a price. Some will fight, some will make noise, there will be serious complaints. But we've started doing that, and I can assure you that we'll start reaping the fruits of that. Because if we don't deal with it, I know it will take time, but if we don't start, which means we'll prolong the problem for even too long, it's better to start. As they say that the journey of 1,000 miles begin with one step forward. That's what we've started.
Now, the battle between Eskom and the Newcastle municipality still rages on. We know that last year the Pietermaritzburg High Court ordered that the municipality should pay about 30 million rand per month to settle the debt. But then you had said that you want to sit with Eskom to discuss on a settlement plan. So what's the progress with regards to that?
The progress is very well, but let me say what the court ordered is what we had proposed to Eskom initially, and they refused. And that's why it ended up in court, but the court agreed with us that this is what we need to pay. But ever since we met with Eskom that time, we've been paying them religiously. What we are finalizing is in terms of paying the area debt, which dates back as far as 2012. Long before even us came here, the debt started accumulating. The discussions are going very well, and I'm sure maybe by this we have concluded with Eskom, because we've offered that this is how much we'll be able to afford, because we need to be realistic. We cannot offer what we cannot afford. We need to offer what the municipality can afford, because the municipality it does not only need to focus on Eskom. We need to pay Eskom, but also we need to focus on making sure that we maintain infrastructure, we develop new infrastructure, we develop the economy of the town, so that we are able to absorb any other problems that we might have in the future. So we are trying to balance that, but I'm happy to say the discussions are going very well. I'm sure by this week, with Eskom, in terms of the area debt, will they have reached an agreement.
But then we're getting reports that Eskom is unrelenting in this particular matter, because they're now threatening to cut off electricity in the municipality. What then happens? Because it'll certainly fly in the face of service delivery, which you said that, you know, is at the top of your agenda.
I don't know where that report is from, because maybe let me say this, because it's a matter of public knowledge. The last time we discussed with Eskom, they were going to come back to us next week. They've never said to us they're going to cut off electricity. That was said last year, and then it went to court. The court ruled that they cannot do that at that time. So that matter has been settled. It's no longer there. The matter that is on the table currently is us agreeing with them in terms of what we can pay in terms of the area debt. They were saying we must pay 7.5 million. Yes, we are paying the current account, even if it's 40, 50 million a month, we are always paying that religious. But the area debt, then that is what is on the table currently. They wanted us to pay about 7.5 million. Now we've put on the table 4.5 million able to pay Eskom. And we are moving from the initial amount, which was about 2.5 million, we're saying now let's settle for at least 4.5 million. And I'm sure that they will accept that, because we're also doing calculations. We cannot go beyond what we can afford. When you agree to service a debt, you must service a debt within your affordability. You cannot service it outside affordability.
Now, let's talk about the salary increases of the ward councillors in the municipality.
There was an issue which went to council, but unfortunately, the MEC wrote back and said, the MEC wrote back that we cannot increase the salaries. We took the matter back to council. The council accepted that, so we are moving on. We'll wait because I think the economic climate and the financial position of the municipality at this stage, I would say we need to focus more on servicing what we owe ESCOM, the loans which were there for the municipality. We need to service that, stabilize the municipality, and then anything else. It's like at home, if you want to have a party for your child, you might want to slaughter 5 cows. But if you can only afford to buy chicken, free-range chicken, you slaughter that, live within that. Don't force the situation, because if you can't afford 5 cows, you can't afford 5 cows. You must be able to spend within what you have, because the challenge that we have, we tend to run government or municipalities. The municipalities like, it runs like a business. You collect revenue, you must be innovative in terms of other revenue strategies so that you are able to spend in terms of your infrastructure and other services and to build the economy also of the municipality. If you don't think in that fashion, then the municipality will never move forward.
All right, Mayor Mahlaba, thank you so much for chatting to us this morning. We appreciate your time.
Thank you very much. Please stay safe.
Will do. That was Newcastle Mayor Dr. Ntutuko Mahlaba joining us via Sky.